All right. Well, thanks very much for having me, for all of you for being here. I'm going to take us a bit back closer to home to start out discussing the SHIFT project. And I want to focus on the reality of work for the millions of workers in the U.S., 10% of the labor force who work in retail and fast food in places like grocery stores and pharmacies. These are the stores and restaurants that most of us patronize every day, Starbucks or Trader Joe's, In-N-Out Burger or Walmart. These are the folks who make our coffee, stock grocery shelves, ring up our purchases, and serve our meals. They aren't just teenagers working first jobs. These are parents and adults struggling to get by. 1 in 10 American children has at least one parent working in retail. And while technology is changing, these jobs aren't expected to disappear or even decline over the coming decades. When we tell the story of inequality in contemporary America, we often focus on the top 1% or 0.1% and how they're pulling ahead. And that's true. But the bottom is also falling behind. Living on little in a prosperous country, working but poor. Part of this is definitely about money. Low wages, lost wages, and fewer fringe benefits. But what I want to put to you, and what our project examines, is that there's something else about job quality that also matters a great deal. There's kind of a dark matter of job quality for low-wage workers. It's big. Advocates and policymakers and press point to it and tell us that it's out there, but it's very difficult for us to measure so far. And what I want to suggest is that dark matter is time, work time. That whereas once workers, you know, fought and won an 8-hour workday, 8 hours for work, 8 hours for rest, 8 hours for what you will, now workers instead contend with work schedules that are volatile, unstable, and unpredictable. We see this in retail and fast food in just-in-time scheduling practices, where nobody's working a 9-to-5 shift, but folks increasingly aren't even working a standard night shift or evening shift or weekends. Instead, the days of the week and the times of day and the number of hours that they work change from week to week and day to day, often with little advance notice. Employees are asked to work on call, or if they come in, they might be sent home early if the store or restaurant is slow, or asked to stay a bit later. These changes occur with little advance notice, and they generate a great deal of disorganization and volatility in workers' schedules. The economic rationale is clear. This lets employers carefully align staffing, a major labor cost, a major cost, with customer demand. But in so doing, they move a lot of risk, it appears, from their payrolls to workers' household financial balance sheets. Advocates suggest that these are common practices with tangible consequences for workers. Here's the game of life for a retail worker that one group put together. And what it suggests is both that these practices are common, you get to work and it's slow and you're sent home, and that the consequences for precarity and block mobility are real. You want to take evening classes, but your boss won't guarantee day shifts. College has to wait. Maybe. But I make the analogy to dark matter because it seems like it's out there, but we haven't been able to measure it. The existing surveys that we rely on in U.S. social and economic policy, the CPS, the ACS, simply don't measure these sorts of practices. We can get a good estimate of wages, but we don't know the share of workers who work on call or receive limited advance notice. And we want to know, what is the reality of work scheduling for this big part of our economy? Does it really matter for work and health well-being? And if it does, what action can companies and policymakers take to do something about it? The data is not out there right now to answer these questions. Our approach has been to take a new way of going about survey data collection. Our insight is that one way to reach large samples of low-wage workers who work at the big firms, Walmart, Target, Safeway, that are the focus of public attention and policymaking, is the same way that U.S. companies reach millions of Americans every day. We are in the advertising business, and we're not particularly good at it, but we use the powerful capabilities of Facebook's ad targeting platform to deliver survey recruitment ads to folks who work at these particular firms, who work at Trader Joe's or Victoria's Secret, Gap, or J. Crew. And using this approach, we've recruited about 60,000 workers to our surveys. These are folks who are employed at 120 of the largest retail and food service firms, in the country. I'll show you some of them in a little bit. This data was collected over the past 2 years, and it contains detailed reports of work scheduling, of household economic insecurity, and of worker and family health and well-being. And what we see is that unpredictability and instability is common in this sector. About over a third of workers report a variable schedule, one that changes from day to day or week to week. Another 20% report a rotating schedule. About two-thirds of workers have a great deal of variability in their work schedules. The regular day shift, or even the regular night shift, is an uncommon proposition. Importantly, this variability plays out with little advance notice. If you knew your variable shift a year ahead, maybe you could make a plan. But in fact, what we see is that one-third of workers knows their schedule less than a week ahead. In fact, 15% only have it less than 3 days ahead. And over two-thirds of workers get less than 2 weeks advance notice of their work schedules. These schedules are variable, and they are also unpredictable. This is what I want to emphasize, is sometimes we use the word flexibility when talking about these practices. What our data from workers show very clearly is that from the employee perspective, this is instability. 84% of our respondents say their schedule is determined entirely or mostly by their employer. 75% strongly agree or agree that they would like a more stable or predictable work schedule. These practices do give employers flexibility to align staffing with demand, but they produce instability for the workers who are subject to these practices. Part of how this works is against the context of insufficient work hours. So we've all read a lot of stories recently about how there's a really tight labor market and big employers like Walmart are having trouble hiring in the holiday season. If that's true, it's a very new change. Just 3 months ago when we surveyed workers, we found that half are working fewer than 35 hours a week, and two-thirds of them would strongly agree or agree that they would like more work hours. That is to say, a third of the workers at these firms both are working less than 35 hours and would like more hours. When you have few hours, you take on these last minute shifts as a way to buttress an already low income. We've begun to look then at how these practices map on to outcome measures related to workers' financial security and their health and well-being. These are just associations from regression models that control for background characteristics, for job tenure and wages. We've got, I think, employer and state fixed effects in here. So we're comparing between workers at the same firm, some of whom have more advance notice, some of whom don't work on call, and some of whom do. A lot of this variation we know from the HR literature is driven by managers. Some managers make the effort to deliver some predictability to workers, and some managers don't have the wherewithal to do that. What we see here is that workers who have more notice, workers who don't work on call, are significantly less likely to experience a material hardship in the last year. For instance, not being able to afford enough to eat. We also see that these practices map on to measures of health and well-being. This is how it maps on to a measure of psychological distress. And what we see is that workers with less advance notice are significantly more likely to experience psychological distress. Workers who work on call are significantly more likely to experience psychological distress. This holds true across the indicators that we might use for these scheduling practices. These practices appear to matter for the workers exposed to them in the moment. How do they translate to overtime processes, to intra and intergenerational mobility? One thing we're looking at is that about a third of the workers in our sample are enrolled in school. If this was flexibility, that might be good. But if it's instability, it may make it very hard for workers to schedule classes and find times to study. It's one thing we're going to be looking at soon. A third of the workers are parents. And we focused in particular on the parents of young children, those aged 0 to 5, and asked how does parental exposure to this instability carry over, if at all, to children. And one thing we've looked at first is how it carries over to childcare arrangements. As the parent of two young children, it is extremely hard for me to make childcare arrangements. Now put yourselves in the shoes of a McDonald's worker with variable shifts and low economic resources. And what we find is this parental exposure to work schedule instability carries over to the complexity and instability of childcare arrangements, things we know matter for healthy child development. So what I want to talk about with my remaining time is some of the things we're beginning to explore that get more at action, informed by this evidence, but also, you know, methods of action that will continue to inform the research base. So the first thing we are going to do here that I'll talk to you about is focusing on firms and asking how we can use our data to inform firm practices and potentially make change. The second thing I'll talk about is a number of things we're doing around policymaking in this area. So a unique thing about the data is that we can identify the firms that employees work at. These are not masked to us. We have no agreement with firms to not disclose who's in our data. And so what we have is a kind of match structure where we have hundreds or thousands of employees, in the case of some firms, nested within large identifiable name brand firms. These are 30 of them. You'll recognize many of them. And there's about 90 more that you would also recognize. What we can do is ask, did everyone race to the bottom? Has everyone adopted the same unstable and unpredictable scheduling practices? Or are there other business models as writ in the different experiences of workers at these otherwise very similar and competing firms? So let me show you that by focusing in on one sector. These are fast food chains in our data. I think there's about 20 of them. And it's mapping the percentage of workers who report working on call in the last month at these firms. And what we see is a great deal of variability in this experience. That at one end of the market, at Rallies and Hardee's and Jack in the Box and Little Caesars, half of workers have had an on-call shift in the last month. But over here, we see something really different. At Starbucks, Panera, Chick-fil-A, and In-N-Out, don't worry, In-N-Out's okay. Just about one in five workers work on call. These are different labor practices in the same industry with among competitors. What can we learn from these high road employers about how other employers could follow suit? Another thing we can do is that employers are beginning to get this message. Pushed by advocates, in the case of Walmart, by their foe, our Walmart, firms have announced changes to labor practices. And we've seen this not beyond Walmart, too. Amazon raises wages to $15 an hour. Changes like this are announced all the time. The question is what actually happens on the ground? Because after you get the good press, do you actually make the change when, in general, no one can know? So we're using our data to try to hold these firms accountable. Walmart announced that they would offer all workers stable and predictable schedules in 2016. We got very excited. This was a great natural experiment we were going to take advantage of. And you know, that's how an experiment design is born. And this is how a design dies. Because what we see with 3,000 interviews with Walmart workers and comparison workers at a set of grocery and big box stores is that nothing changed after Walmart's proposed implementation date. The exact same share of Walmart workers had variable schedules for the 2 years following that. The exact same share had the same amount of hours volatility. The exact same share wanted more stable and predictable work schedules. We're also looking to work on policy in this domain. As many of you know, we've seen a massive policy effort at the state and local level to raise wages, the fight for 15 and higher local and minimum wages. Certainly here in the Bay Area, this has been a place where this has come first, really led the way. What we're now seeing is a move to other kinds of raise-the-floor labor policies, particularly around scheduling, where laws are guaranteeing workers at least 2 weeks advance notice of their work schedules, and at times banning on-call shifts. We've seen these, as policymakers begin to consider legislation like this, they find that there's very little data that lets them characterize what scheduling looks like in their cities and states. And so we've begun to cut our data at the local level and produce reports that can inform this policy making. And we've seen that this can have, I'll tell you that the practices are pretty similar across the country, but if you are a Philadelphia City Council member, that is hard to believe, but it's true. And in fact, this kind of data can inform policy making. We showed up in an editorial in the Philadelphia Inquirer, and just 2 days ago, the Philadelphia City Council voted to advance this legislation. We're also then working with cities that have passed these laws to try to evaluate their effects. Do these laws work? Can employers comply with them? What are the ultimate effects on workers and their well-being? And so we are working with New York City, with the state of Oregon, especially with the city of Seattle to evaluate these laws. In Seattle, workers who work at these same large firms, not small mom and pop firms, are required to get 2 weeks advance notice of their work schedules and are due sort of predictability pay when that requirement is not met. We collected baseline data in the spring of 2017 before the law went into effect. And we find that about half of workers aren't getting that amount of notice pre-implementation. The law went into effect July 1st, 2017. We collected data again last spring, 1 year later, and we're now working on generating some results to tell us how implementation is going, whether workers have gotten more predictable schedules. Finally, we're working with city governments, and in particular in New York City, with the Department of Consumer Affairs' Office of Labor Policy and Standards, to figure out how can we get the word out more effectively about these laws? How can we inform workers about their rights because the way these laws are implemented is a complaint-driven model, in which the only time when employers are investigated or held to account is when it comes up from workers themselves. In general, cities have partnered with a range of nonprofit organizations to do a very high touch, but a pretty small scale, way of informing workers about this. We're working with the city to see if we can use this same Facebook logic and other kinds of social media to deliver paid ads to eligible covered workers that use different frames. Loss aversion, you might be missing out. Claiming your rights, being part of something bigger. Others have been asking about sort of normative signaling to see if we can drive worker knowledge of these laws and so make them more effective once they're passed. So let me conclude by, you know, saying that one thing we're trying to do here is actually measure this thing that everyone thinks matters a lot, but we haven't been able to observe. And when we observe it, we see that schedule unpredictability and instability is common in the sector, and it appears, in associations, consequential for worker health and well-being. We put forward the contention that business and government can act, either through corporate policy or public policy, to shape workers' exposure to these practices. But we need research both to inform that policymaking, then to figure out what works when it's on the ground, and to help actors figure out how to actually make the laws effective. Thanks very much.
Questions for Danny? Yeah, over here.
Yes, you, sir.
Now, what did you do to analyze the cost and benefit for the employer from implementing these policies? Because if you could demonstrate there was some benefit for them, you might have a better shot at getting them implemented.
Yeah, that's great. Like, how can we, you know, these data, this variation suggests that some employers see a different business case, but can we size that? Can we really make that argument? So I think one place where we might see it is that dissatisfied workers may not be very productive workers, particularly in frontline sales occupations. That might really matter for customer experience. And the other thing is that while this is an extremely high turnover business, and it's sort of baked into the costs, it might be beneficial to reduce turnover. So we've begun to follow a section. So in the cross section, we ask workers about satisfaction with their jobs, and we do see strong relationships between these exposures and work satisfaction. We've also begun to follow a subset of these workers, about 3,000 workers in a panel over time. And what we see is there's a lot of turnover, but that turnover is patterned by exposure to these practices. Workers who have more schedule stability, controlling for tenure, are less likely to leave their jobs. And that could really, you know, actualize some business savings for these companies.
And in the same vein, could you actually look within, say, your Walmart data and look for variations across different stores? Because it could be that, like, senior management at Walmart actually thinks it would be better for Walmart, but they can't see what the store managers are doing.
That's great. The advocates like to say, just because Bentonville says it doesn't make it so. That is to say, Walmart believes it has a lot of centralized authority, but in fact, on-the-ground implementation does not always accord with that. So we match workers to their establishments that they work at. We don't have that many workers per establishment. On the other hand, we have now rolled out a new part of the survey that's targeted for managers. So we get about a quarter of our sample identifies some kind of manager. At Walmart, there's like 15 different kinds of managers. And so the module tries to figure out who has authority for making schedules and then asks them both about what they do and what corporate practice is. We'll see how honest people are, but we're trying to get at exactly that issue. Or I shouldn't. I don't know. Can I call the questions? Is that okay? Yeah, please.
What is the cost to the employer? Is it just with a long-term notice of schedules? Is it just the risk of having labor that's not productive? Or if they make a sufficient technology investment, can they predict their labor demands so that they're just as efficient and they're solving their employer problem?
Yeah, that's great. So I do think that the employers see the cost as idle labor. And in very specialized jobs, these are not folks who are necessarily cross-trained to do something else if their primary job, you know, falls short of expectations. Can't technology help? It's a really interesting case because technology enabled a lot of this. Kronos and Day4 are really sophisticated pieces of software that employers use to do the scheduling. What we hear is that they are smart, but they are also quite stupid in the sense that, for instance, at Gap, when there are big sales, that information is conveyed from corporate to stores at the very last minute. They need to staff up, but it's not built into the predictive algorithm. It's also not built in when big deliveries come to the stores. They're just using year-over-year sales, and there's a lot of volatility within that. The other piece of it is that the software is not built to account for any employee preferences with regard to work schedules. But some suggest that it could be. It might run a little longer, but this could certainly be built into the software. Another totally different approach is to give the power to the workers And instead of having centralized scheduling, have a shift swapping piece of software where workers can figure out among themselves, perhaps with some kind of bidding structure, which shifts they want to staff. And I think that's an interesting potential also, because it shifts the locus of control from employers to workers.
I'm curious, in the old days, unions took care of these kinds of abusive labor practices, and we don't have them anymore. So what I was wondering is, did you try to measure anything that would be sort of like the union proxy, which means the level of empowerment collectively of employees at a particular Walmart or a particular Gap or whatever, that could sort of speak collectively with management about making their lives better?
No, it's really great. Union density in the sector is really, really low. It's about 5%, although higher in some subsectors, higher in grocery, for instance, than in these other areas. So one approach is to use some of that variation that exists within the broader retail and service sector and ask if unions play any kind of regulatory role. But they're scarce in this case. Another approach is to see if there are other kinds of worker voice that they can exercise on the job. And we've asked a set of questions just this last round that say, you know, if you had a problem at work, do you feel like you could speak up? That's not, you know, an exogenous source of worker power, but it may capture some of that variation. What was I going to say about this? Thanks.
But it doesn't explain the variation that you see.
No. Thank you.